I want to start with the reason that you're so talked about right now in the news, in the media, online, on social media. And it's a view that you hold that big tech is talking up the threat, the existential threat of AI for a particular reason. Could you outline your thesis to us?
So there's been a lot of fear about AI creating an existential threat to humanity. But I just don't get it. I don't see any plausible path by which AI will make humanity go extinct. But the notion that it could just creates a lot of fear. And unfortunately, this creates cover for lobbyists as well as some regulators to pass laws that I'm concerned will be very stifling on innovation and open source. And so I think it is in the interest of some of the big tech companies to let these regulations be passed to shut out open source that some large companies would probably rather not compete with.
We've just had the AI summit in the UK where many would say perhaps it upped some of the fear-mongering. Are regulations as they're being formed the right ones?
I'm very concerned about the regulations being formed both in the United States as well as in the UK and Europe. One distinction, I feel like there's more of the AI existential risk fear in Europe than in the United States, but I'm concerned about regulations on both sides. So the White House had released an executive order just a couple of weeks ago in which it's starting to put in place reporting requirements and maybe other requirements about models that are very powerful. And I'm very concerned if we'll end with on a path to outlaw open source software, or at least pass regulations that make it so difficult for people to write open source software, free software for anyone to build on, which has been an amazing contribution to the world and is a key for how innovators and startups compete and build.
There was a lot of interest from our audience about you coming on, and I think probably the most common question was for you to explain how you see the intersection of deep learning, machine learning, neural networks impacting jobs. You know, this debate of displacement versus being an assistant based on all of the research and development currently happening.
So it turns out that AI doesn't automate jobs. I know that the whole discussion has been, will AI automate jobs? But I think a more useful analysis is not to think of AI as automating jobs, but as AI automating tasks. So what my teams do is we actually take jobs, break them down into tasks. For example, a radiologist reads x-rays, communicates with patients, gathers patient histories, mentors more junior radiologists, and on and on and on. And then to take all those tasks and figure out where are the AI opportunities. One of my friends, Eric Brinoff, and others had pioneered this technique. And it turns out that, I think I misspoke, AI does automate a tiny number of jobs in whole, but the majority of the time you find that for someone's job, maybe AI can make them, you know, 20% more productive or 30% more productive, which means that they are still needed, but with AI, they can be more productive. I don't mean to minimize the suffering of this much smaller number of people whose jobs will go away, but it turns out also that if you look at most waves of innovation, companies end up pursuing growth more than cost savings, because you can only save so much money. Cost savings is nice, but the growth, the revenue growth has no limit. And so most companies end up, I think, will end up doing more of that.
And companies need to reskill, and that's where Coursera comes in. How much demand have you seen? How much ability to satiate that demand have you been able to give?
So I think Coursera have been privileged to serve many enterprises wanting to reskill their teams. In fact, just about a week ago, we launched a new course, Generative AI for Everyone. I think with this fear and uncertainty, as well as massive upside, we wanted to teach something online to help everyone learn to use generative AI in your own day-to-day life, for personal things or for work, as well as figure out how this will impact your job or your business. So Generative AI for Everyone launched on Coursera just over a week ago. It was actually the fastest growing course on Coursera this year, with I think 43,000 learners signed up in the first 7 days. So I think there's a lot of interest to learn about generative AI and to understand how to use it yourself, how this may affect your job, and how this may affect your business or your industry vertical.
Andrew, this week we've been digesting Grok and the work that Elon Musk's done in generative AI. What is your assessment?
You know, I saw Grok from afar, not played with it myself yet. I think this is a sign of the rapid explosion of AI technology. Just last week, OpenAI had a developer conference. It was exciting. Elon Musk released Grok. I think you just had Kai-Fu Lee on that released another open source model. So this explosion of technology tools. And what will happen is with better tools, it opens up opportunities for businesses and startups to build a lot more applications that just were not possible before. And so I think that with better tools, the application layer, you know, not the media tends to talk about tools because with new technology, that's exciting. People want to hear from the tooling companies. Mm. But tooling companies will be successful only if the applications built on top of them are even more successful and generate even more revenue so they can afford to pay the tooling companies. Yeah. So what I think companies like NVIDIA are brilliant, and AMD and Intel, for them to succeed, someone has made even more money to keep paying for these GPUs. And so I'm excited about the applications involved.